It is a solemn mood in Moscow this morning, for today is the day that Leonid Ilyich Brezhnev, only the fourth man to rule the Soviet Union, is laid to rest. His casket will be taken through Red Square.
Peter, excuse me. This is Lynn Jeffries in Moscow. It's 11 a.m. here, and as the old church bells toll, a throng of millions watches silently, hoping for just one last glimpse of the late Soviet premier. Let's go to Jack Cummings in Red Square. Jack?
Lynn, it's truly astonishing to be here. I'm standing in the middle of a gigantic crowd as a military honor guard marches slowly by, bearing the casket of Leonid Brezhnev. It's most impressive. Wait a minute. Now, all eyes are on something else in the distance. Yes? Yes! Here he comes! Here comes Boomwinkle!
Or two.
And now let's take a look at the halftime stats in this key game on the road to the Super Bowl.
Well, if you look at the turnover spike, I think that just about says it all.
Oh, that's exactly right. Here's where we're seeing the effects of the shortened season.
Of course, they give it right back to them in penalties, just the way they've been doing all season long.
No doubt about it. That roughing the kicker penalty sure changed the momentum of the game.
Oh, boy, did it. Now, when you look at the third down conversions, I think you'll understand that I think you'll understand why ball control is the key thing in a football game. Frontline penetration.
Small coke and a beer.
Frontline penetration and a camaraderie of a championship football team, as these two teams are great championships. It's a flat. It's flat. They came to play. They came to win.
We interrupt this program for a special bulletin. Here's Rich Hall at the news desk.
Where is it? It's not. Nothing to report. I'm sorry.
We now rejoin regularly scheduled programming.
Second half. With the Super Bowl just around the corner, there's tremendous pressure on these players.
There's the handoff to Belly again. He tries the line. Not this time. What a hit.
Ouch. Oh, that looked like a late hit to me, Jim. The ref didn't see it, but the man did.
Oh, wait a minute. I think a player's down on the field. I think it's Stammelman. Yes, it is. Stammelman's hurt.
Oh, boy, I hope it's not that old knee injury. That could put a brilliant player out of commission for... No, it's his feelings. His feelings are hurt. Wow, what a bad break for this championship team. Oh, yeah. They're calling for the analyst. I hope it's not his ego again.
He's always had a delicate personality, and his self-esteem had to be weakened by the strike.
Stammelman's ego has been totally shattered.
sure is for an appetizer. And now for your entree.
Oh, the lady would like lobster thermidor.
Lobster thermidor.
And I'd like pheasant under glass.
Pheasant under glass, bien.
For dessert, chocolate mousse.
Chocolate mousse, très bon.
What kind of wine would you recommend?
Well, we have a superb Cabernet, 1965.
That'll be fine.
Yeah. Enjoy your meal.
Thank you.
Is everything all right?
Plenty. Ordering! One big red, one bird in the window, two chocolate bullwinkles.
Oh, give me another round of caviar for table six.
Tomorrow morning on This Week with David Brinkley, George Will, Sam Donaldson, and Jody Powell discuss the topic, who is cuter, E.T., the Smurfs, or Time Magazine's Man of the Year, the computer? That's 11 Eastern, 10 Central, and who the hell can figure out Mountain?
Senator Dole, please, will you stop that, Senator Dole? Please stop making that noise, Senator Dole. Please stop that. Thank you.
Sunshine St. James, Moon Unit Zappa, God Slick, Zoe Bowie. These are names given to human children by their celebrity parents. Not a pretty thought, is it? Now you can help these innocent victims by donating your time, or what we prefer, your money, to the Distress Center for Children Named by Celebrity Parents. We need your tax-free donations for our institute so that we can help these unfortunates deal with this trauma. And maybe, just maybe, with your help, we can do something before Stevie Nicks has a child. Thank you.
That is circulating around us is not specifically too good.
Please remain seated till we have come to a complete stop. Those of you traveling on to Hawaii and Tokyo can board connecting flights at gate 26.
On your mark, go!
Once again to Talking Picture.
I'm David Osborne.
This is Michael Allen.
And tonight, we're going to rate audience responses to the new Paramount Pictures release, 48 Hours, starring Eddie Murphy and Nick Nolte.
As you know, on Talking Pictures, we obtain our statistics by going out in the streets and questioning people as they come out of the theaters.
I know that, David. That way, we can be certain to obtain their immediate reaction to our surveys. So now, here are the audience responses to our question, did you enjoy the film, 48 Hours?
Film 48 Hours we're doing here today.
48.
Here comes some people right
hours.
Now. Excuse me.
Excuse me. Did you enjoy the film 48 Hours?
Did you enjoy the film 48 Hours?
All right, we'll make sure to... Did you enjoy the film 48 Hours? All right, right back to the studio now. So, the survey showed that in answer to the question, did you enjoy the film 48 Hours, 42% pushed elbowed, screamed an obscenity, or spat at us.
25% punched, kicked, and threatened us with a knife. And a good 19% of those people, when questioned, simply screamed and ran away.
And 12% left by a side exit. Oh, by the way, the both of us rated the film as marvelous.
Oh, wonderful, yes. Well, we hope you enjoyed our little survey, and just a reminder.
Oh, next week, our show, Talking Pictures, will be replaced by our new show in the same time slot, entitled Talking Human Psychology. We'll be showing some fascinating footage about society today when we go out in the streets with our cameras and ask the question, did you enjoy the film 48 Hours?
Please join us then. Good night.
Help me! Over here, lady! Help over here! I'm drowning! Help me, lady! Lady, over here! Over here!
Good evening, I'm Bob Charles, and we just received this bulletin. Peace talks between Pakistan and Afghanistan began tonight, and the first reports out of Karachi indicate that an end to all hostilities may in fact...
Good evening, I'm Jacqueline Pennel with this special bulletin. Fighting has once again broken out on the borders between Pakistan and Afghanistan. Hopes that bilateral peace talks would bring an end to this armed conflict have been smashed by this new military action. I'm Jacqueline Pennel. We'll have more at 11.
Where did you get that story?
I made it up.
You know, that was a really cheap shot.
No, you should talk, Mr. Ethical Journalist.
Nine America, take two. Quiet. Stand by.
Unemployment. It is a word that sends shivers down the spine of anyone who's trying to make ends meet these days. And what better place to examine the ravages of a faltering economy but at a bank, where savings and loans at least cushion the impact of losing one's job. Here is one of the tellers. Excuse me, sir. Have you noticed any increase in the number of people cashing unemployment checks?
Well, yes, I have. It seems almost everybody's out of a job needs the money.
Holmgren, you're supposed to be working.
And I bet a lot of these jobless people try to cash phony checks or draw on accounts that aren't even in their name.
Yeah, I have seen quite a bit of that.
Do you know many people who have been laid off or fired recently?
Oh, sure. A friend of mine who works in a little restaurant right around the corner, he was canned the other day.
Holmgren. This is your last warning, Holmgren.
I'm sorry. Couldn't we do this a little more?
Just one more question. If you were to lose your job, what would you do?
If to lose my job? Oh, I guess I'd run right out.
Let's go home.
I'd kill myself.
Unemployment. The shock, the disappointment, the despair. No one is immune to it, and it's usually those who are least prepared to...
Sir, I plan a morning visit to the orphanage. It won't take long, sir. And then you're meeting Lady Di for lunch. And then I thought it would be fun if you met with those eight prostitutes.
What? All right. Eight. It would, sir. You have to make yourself out there.
Hi, I'm Rich Hall. Boy, the American Dictionary is truly a living piece of heritage, isn't it? Unfortunately, every year there are thousands of words that accidentally get left out. Take, for instance, the word spirits. Everyone knows that spirits are those marks you get on your face after sleeping on a chenille bedspread. Just try to find it in the dictionary. Now, it's important that we use words like spirits in our conversation as much as possible. That way some of these editors might perk up and not make the same mistake twice. Here's another one. Flynn. The black, crusty residue that accumulates on the necks of old ketchup bottles. How it gets there has been baffling science for years. This woman has a lub. A lub is any large particle of food that gets lodged between the teeth. Though relatively harmless in themselves, lubs can lead to much more deep-seated anxiety, such as lub phobia. Fear that everyone in the vicinity has pretty much seen the lub stuck in your teeth. There are plenty of other sadly admitted phobias. Flagrophobia. Fear the cashiers are going to try to charge you for that magazine you've been sneak reading. This, of course, is the most dreaded fear of all, Super megalophobia. Fear that someone's going to wander in on you in a public toilet. This is mankind's greatest fear. Now, collectively, any word that doesn't appear in the dictionary is known as a sniglet. If you've discovered a sniglet, mail it to us. It's sniglet, P.O. 27901, Hollywood, 90027. Now, if we like your sniglet and we decide to use it on the air, we're going to send you one of these great They Like My Sniglet t-shirts. Pretty nifty, huh? Even got that crafty, not necessarily the news logo on the front. So jot down your sniglet and mail it to us today. And by the way, you may notice that little habit you have of dropping a letter in the mailbox and always rechecking to make sure it's gone down is known as tremblemimblemation. All right, that was a tough one, wasn't it?
Right away, sir. Miss Evans, Mr. Rogers, you may go in right now. Oval Office? No, I'm sorry, Mr. Weinberger. The president is in conference right now and cannot be disturbed. Thank you.
What's charming, adorable, and makes you laugh? Lenny Slatkin.
Lenny Slatkin. Lenny Slatkin. How are you?
Lenny Slatkin.
I'm here to audition for the job of the president's show writer.
You're early.
Oh, well, why don't I sit down and make myself comfortable?
Mrs. Thatcher, Mrs. Thatcher, hello. No, the president would know what you're talking about. No, not the foggiest idea. You'll want to talk to Mr. Stockman. Yes, thank you.
Hey, show business, don't you love it? One day, you're in a tavern in Toledo, and the next day, Ben Sue, you're in the White House.
The next day, you're back in Toledo.
I like that, you pizza. Hey, look, can you help me out a little here, cute stuff? What kind of material is the big guy like?
Well, it all depends on his mood. Some days he laughs at everything he hears.
Yeah, go, Lenny.
Oval Office. Calm down, Mr. Schultz. Mr. Meese will decide how important it is. No, I will not disturb the president.
You might ask you a question. Doesn't Mr. President ever take any of these calls himself?
Well, according to Mr. Meese, the job of the president is to remain relaxed at all times in case there's a crisis.
Hey, relax is wonderful. I love relax. Relax is my life. Make people relax, make them laugh. And I can make El Presidente laugh. Hey. I have memorized every joke in the Reader's Digest for the past 6 months.
So has the president.
Okay, good. Good, this is good. Okay, this is good. Makes me think of my feet. It's my strong suit. All right, new ideas. Okay, I'm up. I'm gliding, I'm sliding, I'm moving, I'm singing along, singing a song. Oh, I got it. I got it. No, you can use this one. The Kennedy School of Driving.
I think it's in bad taste.
So what? Forget it. No more Kennedy. I don't know. I forget. I got it. You cut the act in half. Oh, well. 5 minutes. You'll go nuts.
I think you're in luck, Lenny. He loves those old cowboy songs. Sounds like he'll be in a good mood.
Rather Rudy Buckaroody. Okay.
Okay. We go with the MX stuff, then we segue, that's a theatrical term, into Nixon impressions. We get the tapes, Abscan, Donovan.
I have horrible news. I have to see the president immediately.
They don't? Wait a minute. What news? What could be bad?
The Soviets have started a nuclear war.
Okay. It is very bad. But look, I got problems too. I gotta make this guy laugh. And if you go in there and tell him what you gotta tell him first, I'm dead meat.
Hold the phone. I've got it, mon general.
Why don't you let me tell him?
Well, it is only a limited nuclear war in Europe.
All right, you can tell him.
I'm gonna re-enlist. God bless you, General. Maybe you're a prince.
But only if she lets you.
I'm afraid neither of you will be able to see the president today. He started his nap. You'll both have to leave.
Oh, I got it.
No, General.
I got my agent.
Lenny? Go on, Lenny. Go on. Don't touch that. Go on. Get out of here. Lenny? Go. Lenny? Lenny? Come back to me.
There's hope for the boy.
Lenny's not here. Lenny's not here.
Those who yearn to breathe clean intellectual air are in his debt, and we are in his debt. Our former associate, now proud to say the Vice President of the United States, Spiro Ted Agnes.
Hi, you know, all through this show, we've been meaning to give you a 1982 year in review, but somehow the clock has wound down. We're down to 30 seconds, so we're going to make a last-ditch attempt to take a look at the year. Here it is.
Here's Ronnie Reagan calling the plays. He's in his second year, a sophomore, and he takes his tax bill, puts it into action. There it goes over to the House. The House passes it off to the Senate, and there's the Senate, quickly getting bogged down. They give it to a committee. The committee runs with it. Look at that fancy sidestepping and issue avoiding. There it goes back to the Senate. The Senate is going to run downfield. There, back to Reagan. And there's Reagan plowing through public disfavor and, as usual, stuffing it right down the little guy's throat.
Well, it's for 1983. Look for the big matchup to be Reagan versus Congress.
Defense is going to be the key word, and you can bet Reagan is going to be meeting some pretty stiff resistance.
Well, that's the year in a nutshell. From all of us here at Not Necessarily the News, Happy New Year. See you next month.